Now I've heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing.
Shalom. It's wonderful to be with you as we pay tribute to the late, great Leonard Cohen in the most unique of ways, not just through his music, but through personal memories and conversation about Cohen's connections to Israel from Israeli superstar David Broza. I'm Laura Mandel, Executive Director of the Jewish Arts Collaborative, and programs like tonight remind even me of the incredible connective power of the arts. This program is what I call truly beshert, fated. A few months ago, we at J-Arts were looking to pay tribute to Cohen when composer and dear friend Matti Kovler told me that he happened to be recording another project with David Broza, who's known as the Israeli Leonard Cohen. Well, fast forward, and here we are at the story you are about to hear. Before we begin, I want to address a question I've gotten over the last week as to whether or not it's appropriate to have this event right now in light of what's currently happening in Israel. As a leader in peace and coexistence efforts in Israel, I asked David how he felt about this, and his response was simply, how can it be a problem to pay homage to a great Jewish artist in this moment? So with that sentiment in mind, it's my great pleasure to introduce composer and music director Matti Kovler and the great David Broza. Matti.
Thank you, Laura. So first, and before anything else, I should say that it's an honor and a privilege for me personally to participate in this special tribute project, and I thank Michael Rukin's family for generously supporting it. My name is Matti Kovler. I'm an Israeli composer who lived in Boston during my master's and doctorate studies and started my company Floating Tower there. On a personal note, Laura, it's been 15 years that I've known you, and our connection goes back to the time I was just another struggling Israeli artist among the hundreds of Israeli students arriving to Boston each year. And the Jewish Arts Collaborative, the new center back then, was really the major cultural organization in town that understood the importance of embracing the Israeli musicians and artists already living in the community and giving them not only exposure, but also gigs, internships, actual opportunities to perform and connect to the Boston Jewish community. And fast forward, today, when Jewish organizations nationwide study the example you set with J Arts, with all kinds of innovative programming you do, artists, Beit Midrash, creative fellowships, the annual extravaganzas you produce at the MFA, I feel very proud to have witnessed this trajectory evolve. And today's tribute to Leonard Cohen, featuring our own David Broza, stems directly out of this connection. So I hope we prepared something very special for you tonight. First of all, it is the very first time you will hear three brand new original arrangements for Leonard Cohen's signature songs sung by David Broza, who doesn't very often sing covers. And second, we will get an opportunity to talk to David Broza in an intimate way that may not be possible if you were just to attend a usual David Broza show, about his connection to Leonard Cohen, the significance of this connection, the personal significance, in parallel to what Leonard Cohen has experienced. I'll just say that as much as Leonard Cohen's music is really intertwined with the American experience, we Israelis of my generation feel the same way about David Broza, whose guitar playing, intonation, the timbre of his voice that is really tied with the gestalt, with the sound of what Israel is like. For me, when I arrived to Israel in 1990 at the age of 10 with my family from Russia, and immediately the Gulf War started and we were, you know, going in and out of shelters, which is kind of connected to what's happening today. I remember listening on the radio constantly the soundtrack of this experience was Yetov, Yetov. So for me, this is David Broza. For me, David Broza is not just an individual, but he plays a larger role in the soundtrack of what being an Israeli means. And in this, I see the connection. I should say up front that as composers, we don't often have the privilege to be journalists interviewing superstars like David Broza. So I apologize for a certain lack of eloquence, you know, journalistic polishness in this. I'd like to start just by asking David, who is joining us, about your connection to Leonard Cohen. What made you agree to record new arrangements of Leonard Cohen songs in the midst of your otherwise very busy schedule?
Well, Matti, first of all, thank you. Thank you for agreeing to interview or have this conversation. And Laura, thank you for bringing up this idea that I would be able to contribute to your project. It wasn't anywhere on my bucket list, let's put it this way. And it should have been, because like many... exactly like Matti said, the Leonard Cohen soundtrack is part of our lives. You know, anybody who grew up in the latter part of the 20th century, and until recently when, unfortunately, Leonard Cohen passed away, we really followed his voice, especially the Israelis and the Jewish cultural world. Although we know that his career really hit its peak in the last part of his life, where he actually performed around the world endlessly in huge arenas, and everybody, the astounding thing, everybody was singing his words. But I remember his last show in Israel in the football stadium in Ramat Gan, 40,000 people from beginning of the show to the end of the show, Israelis, sang word for word every song. It was as if he was a Kohen, you know, he was the priest. It was amazing. He delivered a poet's magical role in culture. He actually stood on a stage with his magical band and with his very intimate and low voice, delivered these sermons of his, which every poem of his is like a sermon when he sings it. And this is perhaps why I never really wanted to cover any of his, because I thought it was wholesome. What would I contribute? How can I take it elsewhere? And there's several other artists that I've never covered, even for myself as a teenager. So coming out of nowhere, like a left field, Matti meets me briefly in some rehearsal on one of my projects. We have an impressive, explosive, wonderful bonding. And I think not more than an hour later, I get an email or text message. Would you be interested in participating in a project? Blah, blah, blah. And I guess I did, you know, it was just somebody had to pull that moment, you know, like press that button. And I just saw the opportunity. Having said this, now that we've presented these three songs that I picked to cover, I want to say, and I want to commend Matti for this, because it was our first meeting. We didn't even share a plate of food or a glass of wine before this. We still haven't until now. And yet we jumped into the project that he suggested I do. And I thought, what would be more appropriate than seeing how Matti could blend in his world of music with mine, which are not opposites, but very different spectrums. I mean, Matti is a real classical composer and writes a lot for the stage, for Broadway and for that kind of world. And I am a much more intimate folky troubadour, rock and roller. And I have to say that listening now to the recordings, I'm so thrilled. I'm so appreciative also of his openness, because when his world met mine, I had things to say, he had things to say. We kind of, as you'd say in English, we kvetched it until it became what it is, a presentable three items. And one of them is an all-out arrangement that Matti put together. And we really worked it so that it fits my fantasy of singing Leonard Cohen. I was going to say Bob Dylan, imagine. Singing Leonard Cohen and his way of adding the larger sound to it. So I'm just elated and thrilled. And so I thank you, Matti, for this. Now,
very humble.
You know, Leonard Cohen is in everybody's home, I guess, at some point or another, or not everybody, but I'm just trying to generalize. It's such a common sound to have, whether he sings Bird on a Wire or Marion, or whether he sings his latest albums. Something always surfaces again and again with Leonard Cohen and his presence in the musical trajectory of what people listen to. But in my house, there was something a little more exciting, in that my mother was Israel's first folk singer with a guitar. Her name was Shona Aaron. She was a character. And she, by total coincidence, picked up the guitar one day as she was studying actually at the NYU. She came to the United States for a bit and studied in an international house where all the international students live. Everybody was gonna sing a song from their country. She knew two chords on the guitar, she sang. This led to a career of folk songs, and the first ones ever recorded in Hebrew with a guitar. She actually, her first recordings, I think, were in Abbey Road in London. It was apparently it was at the time such a novelty. Nobody knew what Israelis were. Israelis didn't know what they were. Israel was just born, 1948, 1949, 1950.
Tell us, what year was it that your mother was at NYU?
So NYU, I want to say it was like 1946, 1947. Mm-hmm. So Israel was not established yet, but there was Israel. And there was Israel, but there was Israelis. My mother was born in Tel Aviv. She was a Sabra. English was a second language, but she spoke it very fluently, and Hebrew was her language. Mm-hmm. So I guess she was a novelty too in amongst the students.
So mentioned that your mother comes from an Odessa family in Ukraine. Is that correct?
That's far away. Yeah, my great-grandfather.
To Australia, something like that?
So my great-grandfather emigrated to Palestine during the Ottoman Empire in 1880. And settled in what became Rehovot. It was before Rehovot was established. So they were the founding families. As a matter of fact, my grandmother's brother, Eli, he was one of the founders of later on what became the kibbutz, the Ganya. So the family is a family of pioneers. They went through all the cycles and the unhappiness and the impossibility of living in the Middle East in those days. They actually, at some point, my great-grandfather took the family and they moved to Australia for a few years to make a fortune and come back. Anyhow, my mother being obviously very Israeli, singing those songs, then performing around the world with a guitar. She would be invited to Africa, I mean, South Africa, Rhodesia, Ivory Coast, all these countries. Then she'd go to Russia, play in Moscow. And then she, you know, played in England. She had a, you know, huge presence in the United States for the Jews of the diaspora. Suddenly a Hebrew folk singer, you know, Israeli folk singer, singing Erev Shosh Hashanim, Hora Neurim.
Is there a song that we could play just to get a glimpse of Sharon Aaron and also the beautiful woman she was?
Well, she was, you would want to hear her voice. Her voice was very pure.
Play it for us a little bit and then we can see if we can.
I can play something. I never used to sing when my mother was alive. She unfortunately passed away in 2005. But when she was alive, we never really sang much together. We'd sing at home, family events and things, but never really recorded, which is such a shame. I don't know what why that happened, but anyway, that's a fact. So, but one of the songs which I have recently dug out and decided to once in a while perform is this one, very famous. That ערב של שושנים לצנה אל הבוסטן אור בסמים ולבון לרגלך נפתן לילה יורד לאט לרוח שושן נושבה אבא אל חשלך שיר בלה I'm not sure if you can hear all that, but it's that's the gist of the song, Erev Shel Shoshanim, one of those beautiful Hebrew songs written by Yosef Hadar. I don't remember the name of the poet who wrote the words.
The poet I think is Moshe Dor, if I'm not mistaken. Uh-huh. Just to give a glimpse of the English translation of this song that was, of course, sung by David's mother, Sharon Aaron, but also popularized by singers such as Yafa Yarkoni and others.
Dudaim.
Dudaim, a glimpse of the English translation, Evening of Roses, let us go out to the grove, mirth, perfumes is the carpet under your feet. And of course, wow. Shoshanim alludes to the Song of Songs, to Psalms, and it's very fitting for somebody who commands this, who is a priest through music, as you wished. And you mentioned earlier that Leonard Cohen performances was like a high priest, commanding the attention of an audience.
The Kohen.
Through his sermons, a Kohen, which is very much like your performances that I've been to in Israel and everywhere else in the world, where your fans are singing all your songs, that they know them by heart. It made me think when you spoke about your mother, and we will get to speaking about her special connection to Leonard Cohen soon, but it made me think of another parallel that I haven't thought about, because your mother, by coming from a very special family, very rooted in Palestine, by way of Odessa, Australia, Kibbutz Dgania, not very far from Odessa in Lithuania, was born Masha Klonitsky, who was the mother of Leonard Cohen, who was also
really?
Descendant of a very important, yes, Talmudic rabbi. And Leonard Cohen also attributes his love of music to his mother. Very interesting. I just thought about this parallel. Leonard Cohen's mother sang around his house. When Leonard Cohen would pick up his guitar at a restaurant or somewhere, his mother would come and he and his mother would sing to the night. So,
wow. So
it seems that in both David Broza case and Leonard Cohen case, the element of the music comes from the mother. Could you tell us about the significance of your mother's connection to Leonard Cohen, and not only to Leonard Cohen, to other performers who came to Israel and impacted her?
Well, interesting. So I remember as a child, of course, the house was always filled with music. My mother was either practicing songs, and I remember walking sometimes down the street and being afraid to walk back into the street, because while my mother was singing, people would stop on the sidewalk and just listen, you know, because they could hear it through the window. And then I was embarrassed to walk in, you know, because I don't know, it intimidated me. And back in 1960, Israel was very young. And when people like Pete Seeger or Sidney Poitier or Harry Belafonte or Detta or the Platters came to visit Israel, they would want to meet contemporaries, and they were brought to the house. I did perform one time with Pete Seeger just before he passed away. He was 95. And when I was introduced to him by Peter Yarov of Peter, Paul, and Mary, he said, you know, this is the son of Sharona Aaron. And he said, Sharona, you know, and his eyes lit up and he started singing Erev Shoshanim to me. He still remembered that woman. He still remembered her voice, her songs, and wanted to know all about her. So that was sweet. And of course, then comes the connectivity with Leonard Cohen, which is a surprise to me. Much later in life, and I was listening to Leonard Cohen, and then she one day mentions, you know, I knew Leonard. We spent, you know, a couple of weeks or 3 weeks, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks out in Hydra back in 1963. And I'm thinking, wow, tell me more about it. And she was very vague. She never was one of details and would never brag or, you know, boast about it. But I did see that she had a book that he had dedicated to her, a book of poetry, and, you know, to Sharona, thank you for a lovely Shabbat evening, whatever it was on that instant. And when she passed away, that was the one thing I wanted to keep, you know, besides the guitar or some other little details. But that book, you know, meant so much to her. She told me, you're just separated from Marianne. So when you offered that I will participate in this project, the first thing that came to mind is I'm going to sing Marianne, because that connects to the time when my mother was actually got to know him. And there, of course, there was no romance there. There was just a nice friendship. You know, he was a beginning artist, a striving singer-songwriter.
Are you sure about that? Or is...
I'm sure. I'm pretty sure. And yet, who cares? You know, it was a nice memory for her. And it was a nice little anecdote for me. And it really made me want to do these songs, to cover three Leonard Cohen songs. I'm very happy with what I've delivered. And then when I met you, Matti, the way you reacted in such a positivity and musically, you took in my little suggestions. And every time you put your finger on the piano, those notes explode into, I mean, they enhance the harmony and the percussiveness and the weight of every word. It's magical.
Well, first of all, I have to say, I'm very humbled by what you're saying is that, and not every weekend I get an opportunity to sit in my living room and entertain David Broza with a glass of wine. Of course, I was kind of intimidated. With this in mind, I want to invite our audience to imagine yourself the Greek island of Hydra. Leonard Cohen sitting there before becoming the Leonard Cohen that we know, speaking with Sharona Aaron, David Broza's mother, kind of taking in the rhythms of the island. And by the way, one of the typical dances called Hasapiko in Greek influenced one song in particular called Dance Me to the End of Love.
Really?
Yeah, which is a 1984 song, which was first recorded in Leonard Cohen's album, Various Positions. It's a contemplative song about timeliness and death. There's also echoes of the Holocaust in the song, echoes of death camps. So I think this version of Dance Me to the End of Love is kind of swimming in the sounds of memory. So without further ado, let's transition to what it means to have a memory of the things that were and the things that will be, and imagine Sharon Aaron and Leonard Cohen sitting up there at the island of Hydra and dancing to the rhythm of the Greek Hasapiko dance. Dancing to the end of love.
Till I'm gathered safely in, lift me like an olive branch and be my homeward dove. Dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the end of love. Oh, let me see your beauty when the witnesses are gone. Let me feel you moving like they do in Babylon. Show me slowly what I only know the limits of. Dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the end of love. Wedding now, dance me on and on. Dance me very tenderly and dance me very long. We're both of us beneath our love, we're both of us above. Dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the children who are asking to be born. Dance me through the curtains that our kisses have outworn. Raise a tent of shelter now, though every thread is torn. Dance me to the end of love. Dance me to the end of love. End of love.
And so now, after hearing Dance Me to the End of Love, David, you decided to take this song, as you said, into a very different Latino, yeah, Cuban kind of vibe, both for you and for Leonard Cohen, who was described as dizzying. He couldn't remain in one place for more than a few days. He was going all over. We know that you spent time in England and in Spain and in Israel, and you make your home now in Israel, in New York. How does this wanderlust of yours affect your musical preference, specifically the Cuban approach in this song and in other creative pursuits of yours?
Interesting, because so having been born in Israel and then moved to Spain, you know, Spain became a major source of inspiration for my life. It's not just about my music, my lifestyle, food I love, the way I like to spend the days, the evenings, you know, I'm not saying that, I guess I'm not a perfect Spaniard, but I removed myself from being a typical Israeli because I took in so much of that Spanish, which is not Latin, it's really Spanish, Iberian attitude. But because I speak Spanish, it has opened me up to listening and understanding and searching a lot of Latin-oriented projects and music throughout all the years. I'm 65 now, so it's a lot of years of studying and listening and learning. One of the musics that fascinates me for years and years and years has been Cuban music. I just love the deep connectivity of African rhythms with Caribbean, and Cuba has preserved it more than other places. And so luckily, 3 years ago, I met these Cuban musicians who immigrated to the United States at a late stage, like they're over 20. So they grew up the entire growing years in the Cuban disciplinarian system of music. And I was able to transpose all my music, all my songs, all my hits from Sigaliot, except for Yetov. But most of my songs, all the songs that I sing live, were transposed into a Cuban vibe, but a real ethnic Cuban vibe. So when I picked up this song, you know, Dance Me to the End of Love, he does actually, when you were explaining that it's actually comes from a Greek, inspired by a Greek melody, it makes sense because he has that da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Very, very Greek. Very good, really, almost gypsy, but it's Greek.
Like a dance, the Greek dance movements, you can almost feel that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Really beautiful. And had I known this, I wouldn't have moved the way I did, but I took it, you know, to the real very sexy, you know, very different, very, very Caribbean and very Cubano. And I don't know. And it's not that we had Cuban musicians. It was just you and Omer, Avital, the most amazing bass player that I've gotten to play with in recent years. And Morchi, Itai Morchi, this amazing Israeli young drummer who picked the bongos and just created that sound, you know? And then the vibe of all of us together. And I think the audience should know that although it looks like it's all edited and we did it, all these songs were one takes. I mean, I sing the song from beginning to end with the bass and the drums and with Matti on the piano, wherever he's playing in the two songs that he is playing, from A to Z, no edits, no stopping, no correcting. It's what it is. It's literally, if you were sitting in that studio or we are in your living room, this is what it would sound like. So that's what you witness actually.
I think also what we witnessed is, and something that is very difficult to witness in a regular live performance and not Zoom, an insight into you, David, not as an artist and a legend, but also as a mensch. Because, you know, this is something that I think, you know, we can clearly notice. Not only it's important to you to speak about your personal connection, but it's also so important to you to recognize the musicians working with you, including myself. And you speak about Omer Avital, Anytime Morgan, Eitan Goffman, and many other instrumentalists participating in these recordings. I think it's very important to acknowledge that these kind of collaborations are also beneficial for the younger generation of Israeli artists who grow up in between lands. And, you know, for people like myself who spent 15 years in this country and still consider themselves Israelis.
Mate, so, you're a unique story because you come to Israel at the age 11, I believe.
10.
And how from 11 until, let's say, 25, when you moved to the States, perhaps, you created another persona when you immigrated to Israel, obviously. And that persona does not deny the Russian side of you or the Ukraine side of you, but it spices it up, you know? Israeli spices up your original identity, and now you use all these spices in your music. You don't understand. I mean, I hear it now, knowing who you are now, I hear it in your playing. I hear it in the melodies that you, the counterpoints that you bring in.
Thank you very much. And I should just say that I think this illustrates the fluidity, because when you talk about Leonard Cohen, very often you forget about the fact that Leonard Cohen is actually also very much a descendant of people like Irving Berlin. Mm-hmm. You really hear melodies and counterpoint and use chord progressions that are in a way very classical. So this is what also I am inspired by and you're inspired by. When we talk about Leonard Cohen, we often talk about the lyrics of Leonard Cohen, forgetting about mentioning the actual counterpoint and the melodies. And I think I remember reading a quote by Bob Dylan, who described Leonard Cohen as the number one songwriter of their time. And Bob Dylan said specifically, when people talk about Leonard, they fail to mention his melodies, which to me, along with his lyrics, are his greatest genius. They give a celestial character and melodic lift to his songs.
But I have to point out that the real challenge in taking the Leonard Cohen songs on was not creating a melodic reinterpretation. My deepest worry and consideration was, how will I interpret those words? So I am the first to have told them to you. It's most important not to deny Leonard Cohen's genius, but to be able to deliver it so that you're listening to me giving you the oration of Leonard Cohen, but you're hearing it from me for the first time. And this is my commitment to music. This is why I'm at it for so many years. And I never get tired of singing songs that I've written, because the lyrics have always been the center stage. Really, for example, you know, if it's Marianne, I mean, we're not talking about the famous Blue Raincoat, because that's a complete different delivery of a song. But in Marianne, I literally decided, okay, this is to me a rock and roll. And I just took it into a kind of a rock and roll country shuffle and said, I can sing now for the next 5 minutes and you're going to sit and listen, because that's I'm right. going to create this cycle of sound and rhythm. And those words are going to hit you again and again and again. And you'll find out how Marianne has departed. And I'm really trying to hold on to her in the rhythm of the departure. So he's got to keep a rhythm going to hold on. Otherwise, he loses her.
So without further ado, we will now listen to So Long, Marianne, the very first time in the interpretation of David Broza. So Long, Marianne.
Come over to the window, my little darling. I'd like to try to read your palm. I used to think I was some kind of gypsy boy before I let you take me home. Well, you know that I love to live with you, but you make me forget so very much. I forget to pray for the angels, and then the angels forget to pray for us. So long, Marianne, it's time that we were almost young. Deep in the green lilac park, you held on to me like I was a crucifix. As we went kneeling through the dark, your letters, they all say that you're beside me now. Then why do I feel alone? I'm standing on the ledge and your fine spider web is fastening my ankle to a stone. Changed your name again, and just when I climbed this old mountainside to wash my eyelids in the rain.
And now that we listen to the most rock and roll number on this program, I want to move on to one of the more intimate numbers. When at first you told me about the idea of singing in Hebrew, I was surprised. I didn't know that there was a version of the famous Blue Raincoat by Yonatan Geffen that you were singing. So can you tell us a little bit about the genesis of this version?
Well, there never was a version. I never sang this song in Hebrew. My good friend and partner, Yonatan Geffen.
So you never performed it before in Hebrew?
Never. No. I wrote him an email saying, we speak a lot. We speak, every week, a few times a week. For years and years, been 43 years, has been my best friend and buddy and partner in crime. We've written many songs together, from Yetov to endless number of beautiful songs.
For the American listeners, let me just say that Yonatan Geffen, who may be familiar to you more as the father of Aviv Geffen, but Yonatan Geffen is an Israeli, very renowned author, poet, songwriter, playwright, journalist.
And he and I have been working together. That's a story in itself. So I knew that he had written a version of Leonard Cohen in Hebrew, and I thought that there would be something missing if I didn't sing a translation of Leonard Cohen into Hebrew, being that, I'm first and foremost Israeli, and we love Leonard Cohen as if he was literally one of us, and there have been many very beautiful, beautiful renditions and translations of Leonard Cohen poetry and Leonard Cohen songs into Hebrew, sung, recorded, and others just, published to be read. So I wrote Yonatan Geffen, and he wrote me back, yes, about 20-something years ago, I wrote I don't think you ever sang it. I knew I didn't sing it. I hadn't sung it. So he sent it to me. I looked at it. I reread it. I reread the original in English. Then I read other translations. But Yonatan Geffen, his Hebrew is my Hebrew. His Hebrew is the common Hebrew. It's not, in a way, just like Leonard Cohen writes. You know, he writes in a spoken word. He writes he may sway into the Holy Scripture, but he comes back immediately. And you feel as if you're talking to a learned man. Yonatan Geffen too. When you read him, you feel you're reading a learned person. And so to me, this was no compromise. This was exactly what I wanted. But I didn't want to miss out on those who don't listen to Hebrew on a regular basis, who don't understand Hebrew. So I thought maybe I would read a caption of the poem as it was written originally by Leonard Cohen in English. And that would be me. I would be Leonard Cohen writing the letter to the friend. And then I'd become David Broza singing that song in Hebrew, which for now is to me the most powerful rendition in Hebrew, if there's been other recordings, which I haven't checked.
But also I should say to American audiences who are less familiar with Yonatan Geffen's work, that Yonatan Geffen is also very much known and often criticized for his strong political work. He was part of the group of journalists who back in 1973 published the book, The Failure, to document the Yom Kippur War. So much of his work is provocative politically, and this ties into both Leonard Cohen and your own idea of what it means to be an artist, a singer-songwriter in the 21st century. And we know that, you know, you have recently been recognized by the UNICEF, I think, right, David?
Oh, that was 25 years ago on their 50th anniversary.
Oh my goodness. So it was not very recently, but you were a goodwill ambassador.
I was asked to write their anthem or whatever, anthemic piece. And I did, it's called Together, beautiful song that I co-wrote with a great writer from New Orleans, Ramsey McLean, amazing guy.
Is the recording of Together that we can hear a little
bit? It must be on YouTube.
Okay, so let's hear a glimpse of Together and then continue the conversation.
Okay.
Hearing the glimpse of Together, could you tell us a little bit more about why do you think it's important for a singer-songwriter in the 21st century to even have opinions and to act upon them? We know that you have a strong family history. Your mother was one of the founders of Neve Shalom, I believe.
That's my grandfather, yeah.
Your grandfather.
My mother's father.
And could you tell to the American audience who don't know what Neve Shalom is, could you tell us
a little? Oh, yeah, of course. So first of all, as far as politically, you know, I think as citizens, we each have an obligation to enact our rights politically, not only voting, but also protesting and giving your point of view in every country, United States for sure, Israel, absolutely. So when I put down my guitar, I'm out on the streets. If I find that there's a movement that needs more presence of its citizens, and I will join if it resonates with something that resonates with my point of view. I'm more of a social activist. I like to take care of the underprivileged. I like to be sure that those whose voices are not heard will be heard. And that is something that I do probably passed on to me from my grandfather to my parents and to me. My grandfather was founder of Haboni movement, father, of course, later on the Jewish Brigade and the British Army commanded. And he started it. And in his latter years, he founded this village, Israeli-Palestinian village called Neve Shalom Wahat Al-Salam, Oasis of Peace. And the whole notion of establishing it was so to create a some kind of an experimentary society, village, which would have in it people from all the different minorities, and the Jewish, the Muslim, and the Christian living together side by side, and through working life together, would be able to write the protocol for the education that is needed in order to recondition our society and the next generations. And it's been very, very successful. It's very, you know, it's a problematic issue. It never ends, especially in the days that we're witnessing now. It is something that's very, very much needed, that you know, this place where through which you can get the tools with which to build the bridge that will hopefully create the bond between the different minorities and different societies and majorities and the minority. I mean, the Jew and the Arab, or the Jew and the Muslim and the Circus and the Druze and the Christian have to learn to live side by side and together and collaborate and put aside the difficulties. And if you don't educate for that, then it's not gonna come from nowhere. You've got to be educated on it. So the educational system has to be ready for this. And I mean, there's many, I've been involved in many things that, for example, when Peter Yarrow brought a project of his, that he and Peter Paul and Mary had started to introduce and to reduce violence in schools, in the Israeli schools and the Arab schools. I was just, I volunteered to be just an enhancer and help and create that. I'm committed with every breath I take to the improvement and betterment of the situation that is so needs improvement in the underprivileged classes and the underprivileged neighborhoods, underprivileged people in my society, in Israeli society. I would say the same about the United States. I would work in every possible way to help whenever I'm in the United States. I would volunteer. I have many projects, like a 1 million guitar project where I designed and I construct my own guitars, and along with two friends, we've created this foundation where we give away thousands of guitars to underprivileged kids around the United States.
I just want to mention that if you go to davidbroza.net, you will on the very first page see this information about that project.
Yeah, so my involvement is I would say less political, more social oriented, and that comes along with my political inclinations, but this is not what, it doesn't even matter. And Jonathan Geffen, he is a natural partner to me, but he comes from a different family. He comes from the Dayan family. That's a complete different.
I forget, I think he was the nephew of Moshe Dayan, is that true?
That's correct, yeah. The nephew of Moshe Dayan. So that whole family, they have a complete different, different royalty status. Mine is noble, theirs is royal, okay? We don't want to be royal.
With a mention of noble and royal, I would just say
a joke.
I think it is very noble for you to make social activism at the very forefront of what you do, very similar to Leonard Cohen in a way. And it makes me also think about how music can be the soundtrack of the social activism,
absolutely,
whether we realize it or not. And I think it's interesting that in the famous Blue Raincoat, which Leonard Cohen released in 1971 as a part of his third album, Songs of Love and Hate, he makes a reference to Lili Marleen, which is, I had made an arrangement of Lili Marleen for a string orchestra many years ago. And what fascinated me about that song is that it was sung, first of all, during both World Wars, World War I and World War II. It was sung French and in English and in German, and obviously, immortalized by Marlene Dietrich. So this reference to Lili Marleen makes it, to me, very multidimensional. The cognitive dissonance between, the large message of this song and the intimate arrangement that you, David, insisted upon is so powerful to me. When you first came and you said, I want this song to be very, very intimate. I want this to be just a duo between me and the double bass. I was a bit surprised, but then adding only a small part of a very non-vibrato of a string section as a quasi-requiem at the end, to me, it makes perfect, you know, artistic sense to have the famous blue raincoat in such an intimate arrangement. So I'd like to finish this program by playing the famous blue raincoat in this new rendition by David Broza, beginning with a duo with Omer Avital. And before we finish this, of course, I would love to thank David Broza for agreeing to this for us for the very first time to cover the songs of Leonard Cohen. I think you brought something very beautiful to this world. Thank you, Laura, for your vision in making such unusual events in the scope of Jewish community. Thank you, of course, to Michael Rukin's family for supporting this. Thank you to J Arts, and thank you to all of them. Musicians, most of whom are Israeli musicians living in the States, to Danny Shatsky and Vibramonk Studios, the wonderful recording engineer, to Ehud Lazin, the videographer, and to all of the team, the musicians, all of whom you will see in the credits, to Tiv Productions, to David Azulay, and to Jeannie for putting it all together. We are very privileged to have experienced this with you, and we hope to continue doing similar
things. Yes. Definitely. I'm waiting.
So thank you very much, David. And we will finish with famous blue raincoats. Yeah.
Four in the morning, the end of December. I'm writing you now just to see if you're better. New York is cold, but I like where I'm living. There's music on Clinton Street all through the evening. I hear that you're building your little house in the desert. You're living for nothing now. I hope you're keeping some kind of record. Yes. And Jane came by with a lock of your hair. She said that you gave it to her that night, that you planned to go clear. Did you ever go clear? בבוקר, הסוף של דצמבר, כותב רק לראות אם אתה שם בסדר. ניו יורק קפואה, אבל חם לי כשקר לה. בקלינטון סטריט, מוזיקה, עד סוף הלילה. אמרו לי שאתה גר שם לבד, במדבר, אולי אתה קצת מאושר. אחרי שהשיר כבר הושר, אולי גם ממני יש צליל שנשאר. וכן, ג'יין בא אליי עם טלטל, היא אמרה, זה כל מה שנפל ביום בו החלטת שדי. היי, האם אתה חי? חלמתי אותך, איש זקן ופרוע, מעילך המפורסם, הכחול קצת קרוע, ניסית לתפוס רכבות שכבר אין, וחזרת הביתה בלי לילי מרלן, והיא, היא נעלמה לך בלי שתרגיש. וכשהיא חזרה לא חיכה לשום איש, ורואה אותך על דש מעילך שושנים, אתה סתם עוד גנב צועני. טוב ג'יין קמה פתאום, היא מוסרת שלום. סלחתי, ואולי ניפגש בעתיד, ואם תבוא לבקר את ג'יין או אותי, כדאי שתדע האויב כבר נרדם ואני לא לבדי. ותודה על האומץ שלך לנסות, חשבתי לבך מרוסק, אתה גבר חזק. וכן ג'יין באה אליי עם טלטה, היא אמרה זה כל מה שנפל, ביום שהחלטת שדי,
Thank you, David, and all the musicians for such a special evening. I'm Maureen Rukin, and I'm so proud to be representing my family as we remember our father, Michael B. Rukin. Although my dad didn't have a musical bone in his body, he had a love for bringing people together to enjoy music and arts, and I know he would have loved this concert. Tonight, we have honored his memory by bringing beautiful music, Israeli culture, and a wonderful evening together in community. For the past 5 years, it has been our honor to remember Michael through great performances like tonight, because he was so passionate about our Jewish community, the power of music, the importance of Israel, and in coming together to celebrate and connect across backgrounds and beliefs. Thank you to our partners at JArts, the Jewish Arts Collaborative, who brought this program's vision to life and who make it possible for so many of us to connect to our Jewish roots and great art through programs, both in person and online. Tonight was just a sampling of the amazing work that they do. Our family and the foundation's board is so proud to support JArts programming to bring art, music, and culture to the Jewish community and beyond, not only because it honors Michael, but also because of the artistic ways it lets us be Jewish and connects us to Jewish tradition. I have no doubt that you enjoyed tonight's program. So with that, I ask you, I hope that you'll join us in supporting JArts. You can make a gift online right now at jartsboston.org. Again, that's jartsboston.org. Please help us commemorate Michael's passing, which was 10 years ago. It's hard to believe. And if you're so compelled, please go ahead online and make a donation. Thank you. On behalf of the board of the Michael B. Rukin Charitable Foundation, for being with us tonight. Thank you, David Broza, for creating such a special evening for us all. Thank you to the JR staff and leadership who are the heart and brains behind what you experienced tonight. And a special thank you to music director Matti Kovler, without whom tonight would not have been possible. Thank you so much and good night.